How's it going, everyone? Ben Marouski here from FCP Euro with another episode of our Explain series. Today, we are here to talk all about air suspension. As you drive down the road trying to beat that rush hour traffic, I bet you aren't thinking about air suspension. Thoughts of floating over the tarmac on a bed of air just don't come up as you battle your way through a merge onto the highway on your way home. Now, regardless, air suspension is its own science of pounds per square inch that requires some different tools and its own set of rules. Whether you're airing down your GTI, sitting on aftermarket bags for that perfect fitment at a local Cars and Coffee, or airing up your factory air suspension in your Porsche Cayenne to conquer the desert, all air suspension revolves around the same exact principles, and we're here to show you how that all works. Agility and comfort aren't related. Instead, they're usually opposites. Manufacturers know this better than anyone and have come up with several ways to combat that, from magnetic shocks to sway bars that automatically disengage to airbag springs that can change their height on the fly. Aftermarket air spring companies have popped up all over in the last few decades as the technology needed for compact units has advanced. However, BMW, Mercedes-Benz, and Volkswagen have all been optimizing and engineering these systems with companies like Corteco, Bilstein, and other tier one suppliers over years and years of development. Now, for the longest time, at least in the aftermarket, air suspension had become synonymous with primarily stance builds and aftermarket systems. But now we see them everywhere, from track builds to off-road monsters, as they've become more and more common than ever in the new car market. So before we dive too deep, we just kind of want to explain how suspension works in general. Well, at its most basic, the suspension's job is really quite simple. It connects the wheels and the brakes to the vehicle's body, absorbing the bumps while maintaining the tire's grip on the road. Straight and curved links of steel or aluminum, with names like wishbones, control arms, and lateral links, keep the wheel assembly in the center of the wheel well. Now, they use rubber bushings or ball joints to keep the wheel in place, allowing the spring and damper to control body roll and bump control. Modern suspensions use either a coil spring or an airbag spring to absorb the bumps in the road, keeping you comfortable as you drive. The dampers, known as shocks or struts, use a piston mounted on a rod in a sealed tube. The piston moves through the gas or fluid, controlling the compression and rebound of the spring, preventing the car from bouncing. The damper works in conjunction with the spring to absorb the bumps and keep the vehicle controlled through the corners. Now, like you'll find in BMW sedans, traditional coil springs come in two varieties. There's linear and there's progressive. Linear springs have a single compression rate no matter how much they're compressed. On the other hand, progressive springs get stiffer as they're compressed. As a result, where linear springs work best in a single application, sacrificing comfort for performance or vice versa, progressives really aren't best at any one thing, rather mediocre at everything. They're basically the all-season of springs. One of the other options out there is air suspension. Air suspension throws conventional springs right out the window for a cylindrical rubber bladder filled with air. A compressor in the vehicle supplies the bladders, and they're both managed by a control module. Each air spring is monitored by the module for pressure and height and is adjusted accordingly to whatever the driver or computer wants to see. Now, the bellow or bag that acts as a spring is made from rubber or elastomer, strengthened with cords to provide durability along with the elasticity needed to give a compliant ride. Corteco, the OE air suspension supplier to Mercedes-Benz, BMW, and Volkswagen, layer their reinforcing cords in parallel and in crossing patterns within the elastomer, allowing the bags to have sharp responsiveness and retain torsional stability as intended by the OE design. Now, each bag is given a target air pressure rating by the control module. When pressure is low, the compressor pumps up more air into the specified springs, raising the ride height and stiffness. Excessive pressure in the springs means its air is diverted to a small reservoir or expelled to the atmosphere. Think of a blow-off valve for your suspension. The top of the bellow is crimped to the upper suspension mount, while the bottom is fixed to a piston on the damper. The piston is mounted on the top of the damper and moves inside the bellow as the spring compresses. The air pressure inside the bellow and the shape of the piston determine the spring stiffness. Now, together, the air spring and the damper it sits on make up an air strut. So, how did we get to this point? Well, the history and the idea of air suspension can be traced back to the early 1900s, though its first real practical application came during the Second World War, which you may notice that theme within a lot of these videos. The automotive industry took a lot from wartime engineering. American trucks and aircraft were fitted with the air suspension to provide a stable ride height when fitted with heavy artillery and supplies. Air suspension saw its first practical use on streetcars in 1950 when Airlift created an air spring insert that worked in conjunction with a traditional coil spring. They quickly caught on in stock car racing and were used successfully for several decades. American vehicles had optional air suspension in the late 50s, while Mercedes-Benz became the first major German automaker to use it in 1961 on their 300 SE. From there, in the late 90s, Mercedes introduced the airmatic suspension, combining the basic idea of an air spring with their adaptive dampers to create an all-in-one unit that vastly enhanced the comfort and handling abilities of their suspension. The electronically controlled suspension was able to set the ride height at each corner of the vehicle automatically, something they really hadn't been able to do since their hydropneumatic suspension of the 60s. Now fast forward to the mid-2000s, and the airmatic received a few key updates. Mercedes' advanced in damper technology allowed their air struts to read and adapt to road conditions in 50 milliseconds. That's twice as fast as the average human can blink. This meant drivers could also select their damper settings at the push of a button. Now by this time, nearly all major manufacturers had caught on to the advantages of air suspension. The Porsche's Cayenne Turbo came with it as standard, and it still does today. And in fact, you'd be hard pressed to find a luxury SUV that doesn't use air suspension in some capacity. Mercedes AMG cars, BMW's M-badged SUVs, and Porsche's range-topping SUVs and sedans use some form of air spring or air strut. Current suspension technology has allowed the manufacturers to use air springs and adjustable dampers to provide their models with several different suspension settings. BMW and Mercedes AMG models can use their adaptive air suspensions to change their ride qualities from ultimate comfort all the way to ultimate performance. So looking at the aftermarket versus OE option, what's the real difference? Well, aftermarket air suspension systems are actually pretty fairly easy to come by nowadays. Companies like X2 Industries and Airlift Performance offer complete kits for various BMWs, Mercedes, Audis, Volkswagens, and more. However, OEM air suspension systems are quite different from the aftermarket equivalents. An aftermarket system can give you some of the performance of an OE system, but it will come with several drawbacks. Today's European luxury vehicles will have their compressors and reservoir tanks tucked out of the way and into a spot specifically designed for them. Your Mark IV GTI won't have a spot for those things from the factory. Instead, space will need it to be made in the trunk somewhere if you want to continue to use your back seats. Airing up takes a lot of air, so you'll need a large tank to hold that air. Too small a tank and you'll constantly have the compressor running to refill the system. So with the air compressor and air tank mounted in the car, you now need to be able to run your air lines to each corner of the vehicle. The easiest way to do that on a vehicle not originally equipped with air suspension is to drill and cut into the body. The holes in mounting can be made neatly, but not everyone is okay with hacking up their car. That said, this is where a lot of the creativity comes into play with people installing aftermarket systems in their vehicles. Now, moving on from the differences on how an aftermarket system and an OE system are actually mounted in the car, let's look at some of the materials they use. Aftermarket bellows use an elastomer compound impregnated with cord like the OE Corteco pieces. However, they aren't built to the same quality. Non-OE systems don't have to meet the same rigorous standards of the manufacturers, so they can get away with using thick bellows meant for trucks and the same piston design for every single application. Unfortunately, that standard thickness means that the springs are less flexible than the original springs and will be significantly less responsive than the OE supplied design. That money-saving move for the aftermarket competitors is a direct cause for their higher failure rate. Their one-size-fits-all approach uses a bellow that can't always cope with the specific requirements of the chassis that they're on. So from there, we move on to the dampers themselves, which send the OE air suspension systems into a league of their own. Mercedes and BMW use various sensors and cameras to read the road conditions and adjust the damping and air pressure on the fly to keep the car controlled and comfortable. Aftermarket solutions won't have anything like that. Instead, you'll typically find a single adjustment knob on each strut to change the compression damping, leaving your air suspension to handle whatever conditions you really put it through. So one of the elephants in the room for either an OE system or aftermarket system is the upkeep. So costs are really always a factor when you need to replace parts, which is actually another win for the OE quality units. Now comparing the maintenance of an air suspension system compared to a traditional one is quite a bit different as well. Traditional setups have the damper shaft covered by a loosely fitting rubber boot with the spring exposed to the elements. Dust and dirt often find their way past the boot and onto the damper shaft. A seal keeps the dirt out of the damper, but it can scratch the shaft, causing it to leak fluid and lose its effectiveness. The coil spring itself can sometimes have a rubber or plastic guard protecting it, but they're usually left exposed. So constant bombardment from dust and dirt particles will eat through the spring's paint and cause it to rust. If you've ever taken off your wheel, I'm sure you've seen this on your suspension. Now, air springs and struts, on the other hand, are sealed units. Dirt and grit can collect on the outside of the spring, but spraying it down with a hose should get most of that off. You'll only really have to worry about the system springing a leak. A spray bottle filled with soapy water will let you know of any components you may suspect of leaking. Simply just spray the soapy mixture on the corner under suspicion and watch for any bubbles to form. Now that said, air suspension systems, as we've explained, are a bit more complex since the entire system works as one whole. Now there are electronics, there's airlines, sensors, tanks, and all of those things can have issues on their own. Coming from me personally, the air suspension system on my 12-year-old Cayenne has left me and my family stranded already a handful of times for things such as a failing compressor, a valve block that was not communicating correctly, and even a level sensor that popped off. Nonetheless, all of the aforementioned parts are serviceable items, and with the familiarity of your system, a scan tool, and some soapy water, most issues are easy enough to nail down and diagnose. But these are still issues you would never really run into with a traditional setup. So, broad stroke, that's about all you need to know about air suspension for now. At the end of the day, stick with a suspension that works for you. Coil springs are cheap and robust, but it's tough to beat OE quality air suspension for maximum versatility. If you have any questions or comments regarding air suspension, please leave them below. If you enjoyed this video, hit that like button and subscribe if you haven't already. As always, we appreciate you watching. We will see you on the next one.